Come on, let's give God praise in this house. Amen. He deserves the glory. He deserves the honor. He deserves the praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many's ever been done wrong by someone? Come on now. You know we've all been done wrong by someone. Amen. How many's ever been done right by someone? Amen. Well, guess what? Tonight, Jesus is going to do you right. Amen. Now, we do something where Pastor Texas said that he's just going to let us do the whole service and do it our way, all right? So we're going to do something a little different tonight, okay? We're going to sing an old song that says, "Can't nobody do me like Jesus," all right? So I want you to go out and I want you to shake someone's hand and say, "Can't nobody do me like Jesus," all right? Well, can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody do me like the Lord. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. He is my friend. Can't nobody, come on, tell him. Well, can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Can't nobody touch me like Jesus.
Jesus.
Can't nobody touch me like Jesus.
Can't nobody save me like Jesus. There's a lot of people out there that'll say they're your friend, all right? But when the going gets tough, those friends get going. Oh, did you hear me today? Oh, break it down just a little bit. Amen. There's a lot of people out there that'll tell you that they are your friend. But when the going gets tough, those friends get going. Come on now. But our God, amen, our friend, what a friend we have in Jesus. He said he will stick closer to you than a brother, amen, that he will lay his life down for you, that he will never forsake you, he'll never leave you, amen. He said he will be with you. David said, if I lay my bed in hell, there you are with me. So that's the Jesus we're talking about tonight, amen. So we're going to sing it one more time, amen. I want you to get a fathom of what you're singing about tonight, because Jesus is the dearest friend that you will ever have, my friend, amen. He will heal your body, he will save your soul, he will touch your mind, he will make you whole, because he is your friend. Somebody say, can't nobody, well now can't nobody do me like Jesus, can't nobody do me like the Lord. Say nobody. Well, nobody. And he is my friend. He's my friend. And he is my friend. He's my friend. He is my friend. Come on, put your hands together, amen. If he's your friend tonight, hallelujah, hallelujah. He is the dearest friend that we will ever have, amen. When I was today, I was thinking, you know, as I was sitting there in the hotel and I was praying, and I thought about the story of Job. You know, Job, as this wind was kind of boisterous last night, you know, and it was blowing away, and when we got back to the hotel room, the person at the front desk, she was so worried, and I told her, I said, it's all right. And she said, well, how do you know it's all right? I said, because I've prayed. And she said, well, what makes that so great? I said, because my Father hears my prayers. Amen. I have a good Father. Amen. Now, hear me today. Amen. The Bible says that Job had sons and daughters, and the wind blew in and took them all away. But none through any of that did he charge God for the wind. hand. Amen. But what he did do, he said, blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. So can we put our hands together and blessed be the name of the Lord? Amen. Can we say, amen, though he may slay me, yet I will serve him. Hallelujah. Come on, like this. Blessed be the name.
Yes.
Through the wilderness.
Oh, and blessed be your name.
There we go.
Blessed be your name
on a road marked with suffering, though there is pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing. I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name in a land that is plentiful, where the streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in that desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Come on, every blessing. In every blessing. Closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name. Blessed be your name when the sun is shining down on me, when the world is all as it should be.
Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name on a road marked with suffering, though there is pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Oh, every blessing, every blessing. Closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name.
Blessed be your name. Savior, he
Can you lift your hands toward heaven?
Hallelujah.
Say, Father God, Lord, we know that you can move every mountain, Father, and change it. Lord God, we know that you rose and that you conquered the grave, Lord Jesus. And we've come to worship you and we've come to honor you in this place. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this house. Holy Spirit, we invite you to move amongst your people tonight. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and I've seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. It's in your Come on, church, lift your hands and sing this with me tonight. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come and flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence. Lord and Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come and flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Only in your presence, Lord. And Holy Spirit, you are well. And fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. In your overcome by your presence, Lord and Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come and flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. It's in your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness.
Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord and Holy Spirit. You are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, welcome here tonight.
Come
have your way, Lord, in every heart, Lord. Every man, every woman, every child in this premises, Father God. I pray tonight, Holy Ghost, that you will have your way, Lord. God, that you will allow heaven and earth to collide in this place, Lord. That your will shall be done, Lord, in this place as it is in heaven, Lord. God, I pray, God, that you will, Lord, do only what you can do, Lord. For you can do the impossible, God. You command the wind to cease, Lord. You command the storm to still. God, you command the blind to see, Lord. You command the lame to walk, Lord. You command the dumb to talk, Father God. And Lord, today, God, I command every foul and demonic force that's trying to come against, Lord, this church and this community, that it has to flee, it has to be gone in the name of Jesus, of whose we are and whom we serve. And I pray tonight, Holy Spirit, have your way, have your way, have your way, have your way. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your
more aware glory, God, is what our hearts
show us your glory tonight, God.
To be
show us your glory tonight
by your presence,
Lord and Holy Spirit. You are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill your atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for.
To be
Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us this privilege, Lord. God, to be in your presence, Lord, among your people, Lord, in your house, Father. Oh, si corabosanda la bocai, ila la bosanda la bosi coraboho. Father God, I pray that God, you will, Lord, show your glory, God, to my brothers and my sisters here tonight, God. Lord, reveal yourself to them, Lord God, like never before, Father God. Oh, God, I pray tonight, God, Lord, that you will, Lord, just show up and show forth, Father God. And I pray, God, for every soul, Lord, every mind, God, every, Lord, ailment, God, every need that we have expressed, Father God. Lord, you are all that we need, and we give you praise, Lord. We give you praise tonight for what you're going to do tonight, what you're going to do tomorrow night, what you're going to do Wednesday night, what you're going to do Thursday night, what you're going to do Friday night, what you're going to do in 2017, Father God. We give you praise now, Lord. We give you praise now, Lord. Oh God, I pray, Lord, help us to not become so familiar, Lord, with your spirit, God, that we get so comfortable, Lord. Oh God, you said that if we are comfortable, that if we are lukewarm, that you will spit us out, Lord. But help us tonight to be on fire for you, Father God, I pray. Lord, I pray, God, that you will touch us tonight, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. And I pray that you will have your way in this place as in heaven. And I pray this all in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's people say amen and amen. Can you give the Lord praise? Come on, as your pastor comes, can you give the Lord praise? Can you put your hands together and give him your best praise ever? Can you give him a shout of praise? Amen. Amen. A shout of victory. A shout of triumph. Amen. Whose report are you going to believe? I'm going to believe the report of the Lord. His report says, I am healed, I am filled, and I have victory in Jesus. Amen. I feel the presence of the Lord in this place. I don't know if you feel what I feel, but I feel the presence. I'm about to run up. I'm about to hop a pew. My God, my God, I feel the presence of the Holy Ghost in this place. And the Lord is wanting to move on your behalf. He's wanting to move on your behalf. He's wanting to move on your behalf. But you've got to allow him. You've got to ask him. Let your supplication be known. Amen. He said you have not because you ask not. So tonight, I don't know about you, but I'm asking, Lord, for more of you, more of your presence, more of your glory, that I may decrease and that you may increase in Jesus' mighty name. So one more time, I'm going to give you one more chance to give the Lord your best praise ever. My God, my God, my God.
Woo! You ready to preach right now? Hallelujah. Come on and shout unto the Lord with the voice of triumph. Come on, church. Hallelujah. Woo. Oh, don't stop now just because he stopped. Come on. Come on. Give the Lord a praise. Come on. Give him praise in this house. Hallelujah. As he was speaking and sharing and singing that song, and the Lord spoke to us, I just did the numbers 14 years ago, and said, go back and build a place for my presence. And that's what he's done. God has built a place in his presence. Amen. I want to read a passage of scripture that the Lord spoke to us, and it confirms everything that's happening now, this revival. And out of Ezekiel 33, the Lord spoke this to Ty and I in 2002. I want you to listen. You say, why do you do what you do? Why do we have evangelists come? Why do we have men and women of God to come and preach the word of God? Why do we do outreach? And why do we try to do this? It's because we have a mandate. Come on, we say that with me. We have a mandate. We have a mandate as the pastors. We have a mandate as a church. And I want you to hear this. And he said, again, the word of the Lord came to me saying, son of man, speak to the children of your people and say to them. Oh, listen now. When I bring the sword, when I bring the sword upon a land, and the people of the land take a man from their territory and make him their watchman. Oh, listen to this. This defies everything. When he sees the sword coming upon the land, if he blows the trumpet and warns the people, then whoever hears the sound of the trumpet and does not take warning, if the sword comes and takes him away, his blood shall be on his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet, but did not take warning, his blood shall be upon himself, but he who takes warning will save his life. But if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet, and the people are not warned, and the sword comes and takes any person from among them, he is taken away in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at the watchman's hand. Listen. So you see, son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel. Therefore you shall hear a word from my mouth and warn them for me. When I say to the wicked, O wicked man, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked from his way, at the wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. Nevertheless, if you warn the wicked, you warn those that needs to hear the word of God, to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, he shall die in his iniquity, but you have delivered your soul. Therefore you, O son of man, say to the house of Israel, say to this house, thus you say, if our transgressions and our sins lie upon us, and we pine away in them, how can we then live? Wow. You say, Pastor, what does that mean? That is why I do what I do. I have not left that mandate. That's the reason why that I have men of God like this man of God and this woman of God and the great men and women of God over the last 14 years to come in this house to give the word and give the message to you that are watching right now and to you that are watching right now to give the word. And if you don't heed it, I do not want your blood. I do not want your blood, and I don't want your blood on my head. So tonight, the presence of God is here. The worship and the presence of the Lord is in this room. And I want you to get a biggest offering you can, because I believe that when the Word of God speaks to us, we need to give, and we need revival releases your finances. Are you hearing me? Revival releases your finances because you go and you get ready to give and give something out of it. I'm going to tell you something. Get something in your hand right now. Get something in your hand. If you come prepared with your revival envelope, you come prepared to give a great offering tonight. Put something in your hand right now to give in this revival. You say, well, Pastor, I hadn't got paid yet. Well, you make that commitment. Why don't you take an envelope? Why don't you make a commitment saying, I will give this amount in this revival the next few nights. Let's believe, because that mandate that God has given to Sister Ty and I, we was in our living room in in October of 2002, and the Lord spoke that to us, and we knew what we had to do, and it didn't come into play until the middle of summer of 2003. I sat in some of your homes and told you what God was going to do, and He's done it. And I've been here to tell you tonight, God has brought a man of God and a pastor, an evangelist, and a family to minister to with us, and I want to challenge you to give in this offering tonight like you've never done before. Can you join with me with this mandate? It takes dollars to do mandate. Come on, are you listening to me? I want our ushers to get ready to come, if you would. Edward, Sister Joyce, come right on. I want you tonight to let God's word speak into your heart. Because I know that I know that I know down in my knower that God is ordaining something. You know, Bishop, the revival is a process. It's a process. It builds. It builds. You know, every night it can build and build and build and build. I don't know what's going to happen Wednesday night. I know they've got a schedule, but if God says to go on, we'll have revival. Go right on. I'm talking about if they can't stay, we will carry it on. All right? Somebody who can preach. I got somebody waiting on the phone call for me if I want them to come. I'm just waiting on the Holy Spirit. Because I believe the Lord spoke to me, this is the time for revival. This is the time for revival. But you got to give out of your finances and plant some seeds in this revival. Somebody needs to write a $1,000 check. Somebody needs to write a $100 check. Some of you are planning on trips. You're going to spend $2,000 or $3,000 on. Some of you planning on trips are going to cost you $150, $200 to go on. Why don't you give it into the kingdom of God and watch God multiply it? Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm watching and waiting for the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. And I'm telling you, we're in a season. I don't mean to carry this on, but we're in a season of an abundance. God is fixing to bless. Let me tell you what, I listen today. I am so intently what's going on in our nation today. I'm telling you, God is going to honor to the church in this hour. I listen today to our president and our vice president as they set forth their administrators. And you know what they did? They read a scripture out of Isaiah 43 verse 1. And they prayed in Jesus' name. I about shouted off my seat. I posted, it's about time. Glory to God. That was happening right in the White House, in the East Room. Glory to God. I'm praying that God will send some folks up there and do some cleansing. Hallelujah. He's doing it. I don't know about you, but I want to be a part of what God is doing. I want to be a part of what God is doing in Ocala, Florida. I've been to their church there. I don't know how they pack so many people in that modular unit, but they're fixing to build a building that'll seat how many? About 600 people, and God is blessing them, and it's going to be debt-free. Is it going to be debt-free? You believe in it? We're believing that too. Amen. So I want you tonight to plant a seed in their ministry. I tell you what, this, Caleb, you're doing a wonderful job. But I'll tell you what, son, you have got a voice on you. One of these young men up here said, he went on the line and sang that song and said, it sounds just like you. I think his name is Zach. Somebody sings that? Is that what it is? Awesome. Have you enjoyed the ministry? Well, give into that. Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the ministry and the work of God and your presence in this room. And Lord, I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing right now. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you as you give tonight. Amen. God bless you. I'm going to just turn it right over back to them. Bishop, when they get through, you come right onto the pulpit. Heard, blood is falling, oh, how glorious.
Come on, come on. Let's give God praise. Amen. Let's give God praise. Beautiful one. Amen. He is. Somebody say, He is. He is the beautiful one. Amen. I'm so proud of my family. Amen. For Eden and Joshua and Caleb and Sister Melissa. Can you give them appreciation today? Amen. Appreciation tonight. Let me say thank you for all of your hospitality. Thank you for each and every one that are cooking. Wow, we ate so good today and yesterday. And I tell you, man, people in Wachula know how to cook. Wow. I'm not much of a cook, but I'm a great eater. Amen. You know, you cook it and I'll eat it. Collard greens and everything else. Man, I like it all. But I want to say thank you to your pastor. Thank you so much for having us. Amen. It is a joy. It's an honor. And truly, I feel the presence of the Lord in this place. I feel the presence of the Lord in this place. I truly do. You see, if there was one indictment that would come against the church, I would say that we've become too familiar with the presence of the Lord. I would say that we have become too familiar, amen, with the movement of the Holy Ghost. Amen. In other words, our hearts are hardened and we're not stirred like we used to be stirred. Amen. Can you remember a time when things used to stir you? You know, we've grown hard and hard. You know, our heart has grown hardened. And over time, whether it's been through sickness or illness or divorce or disease or addiction or whatever it might be. But hear me today, as I told you yesterday, that God will restore unto you the years that the locust has eaten away. Amen. Some of you need to hear that tonight, that He will restore unto you the years that the enemy has taken from you. Amen. He did not say days. His word said that He will restore unto you the years that the enemy has stolen from you today. And we just rejoice in God, knowing that He is in control. Amen. And as I was praying this morning, and I was just praying of what to preach tonight. The Lord just totally took me His way, not my way. So I just pray that, amen, that there's someone here that this is for. Well, I know that there is someone here that this is for, because this is what God has given me. And if you will, turn your Bible to the book of Acts chapter 28. And as you're turning there, let me say thank you for your monetary gifts. We do pastor, and we are on salary there at the church, but what we do with our offerings when we evangelize is we give out a lot of Bibles. I have a case of Bibles out here. We give out, I think, what was it, Tuesday night, how many Bibles did we give out? Lord, we gave out to 25-30 Bibles to college kids, and we do a lot of that with the gifts that are received when we evangelize. We'll go anywhere God will open the door, and it's not about money. Little is much when God is in it. Amen. And you might not be able to give what the person next to you can give, but hear me about giving. It's not about that. It's about the sacrifice. It's not about the equal gift. It's about the equal sacrifice. Think about the widow woman that had the mite, all right? Jesus said she gave more than all of these men that had all this money, all right? So little is much when God is getting it. So it's about the sacrifice. sacrifice, and we thank you. We thank you for your sacrifice. We give out Bibles on campuses of high schools, of colleges. We give out lots and lots and lots of literature, and that literature is expensive. You can imagine as far as even the Bibles. I am not a Gideon, so my Bibles are specific. Sometimes they're even sports specific. If I go to football players and a team will let me in, I will get them a Bible based on, it's a football Bible. Believe it or not, they make anything nowadays. Now, it's the Word of God, but it has testimonies of guys that played, Tony Dungy and people like that, Tim Tebow, and has their testimonies in there, and it attracts the young men, and even girls softball and girls volleyball and things like that, and basketball. And so those things are not, I'm not a Gideon, amen, and I praise God for them, but we do what God has called us to do. So we thank you for your gifts, okay? So Acts chapter 28. Some of you are thinking, what in the world is he? Man, he's up there. The Spirit of God done got him drunk. Praise the Lord. Acts chapter 28. The Bible says, and when they were escaped, they being Paul and all the prisoners on a ship bound for Rome. Now, if you read chapter 27, you will find that Paul was in prison and that he was being extradited to Rome on a ship, that he was a prisoner, that he had many people on there, and that it was a long, long trip, and they had to stop many times because of storms, and their ship was battered, it was beaten, it was a lot like the boisterous wind that we saw last night, and finally that ship wrecked. Okay, that ship wrecked. All right, some of you feel like a shipwreck right now, don't you? Amen, you feel like a shipwreck. Amen, but when they were all escaped, now you got to remember is that in chapter 27, you'll find out that the centurion, the Roman guard, that he was going to kill all the prisoners, but the angel of the Lord came to Paul and told Paul that everyone will survive. So Paul told this to the guard, and he said, I know that God has spoken to me, and that everyone will survive, so you don't have to kill them. And I'm paraphrasing all of this to bring us up to chapter 28. Okay, so the ship wrecked, and they finally comes verse 28. And when they were escaped, then they knew that the island they landed on was Melita. In my church, I have a man and woman from Melita. They're from Melita, and there in Melita, the people were barbarous. They were barbarous people, and they showed us no little kindness. Now, what that means is they showed us a lot of kindness, for they kindled a fire. Somebody say, kindled a fire. And they received us, every one, because of the present rain and because of the cold. And when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, there came a viper out of the heat and fastened on his hand. And when the barbarians saw that the venomous beast hang on his hand, they said among themselves, "There's no doubt that this man is a murderer, whom though he hath escaped the sea, yet vengeance suffereth him now not to live." And the Bible says in verse 5 of chapter 28 of the book of Acts that Paul shook off the beast. Somebody say, shake it off. He shook off the beast into the fire, and he felt no harm. Now that's just some good advice right there. You need to shake it off. Come on now, you need to shake it off. Now my wife, she grew up as an evangelist. I did not. All right, I grew up as a pastor's kid, amen, and I'm the baby of six. So I was babied. All right, my mother thinks I am her favorite.
I am my father's favorite. I am my mother's favorite. I didn't get hand-me-downs. They bought me all new stuff. All right? So I was very spoiled as a child. All right? As a child. All right? But my wife, she has a philosophy, and it's called a Peyton Manning philosophy. Just rub some dirt on it. That's what she'll tell me. You see, I want to throw a pity party, and I want her to come and join me. But she said, no, I'm not going to join that party. You got to get over it, boy. That's what she'll tell me. She'll tell me, you got to get over it. But here we see that he shook off the beast into the fire, and he felt no harm. Now, howbeit they looked when he should have swollen, or he should have fallen down dead suddenly. But after they had looked a great while and saw him, no harm come to him, they changed their minds about him and said that he was a god. Now in the same quarters were possessions of the chief man of the island, whose name was Publius, who received us and lodged us 3 days courteously. And it came to pass that the father of Publius lay sick of a fever and of a bloody flux, to whom Paul entered in and prayed. And what did he do to him? He laid his hands on him and healed him. And now I'm a firm believer in laying on of hands. James tells us that we are to call on the elders, that we are to anoint them, lay hands upon them, and pray the prayer of faith, and they shall recover. Now, I believe that. Amen. I believe that. And if you believe that tonight, if you are sick, you're going to leave here changed in Jesus' name. Amen. So he laid hands on him, amen, and healed him. So when this was done, others also which had diseases in the island, they came and they were healed. Do you know that when people get word, amen, that Wachula here at Faith Temple Church of God, at Faith Temple Church of God, when people in Wachula and Avon Park and Sebring and all over the place get word that God is here in the very midst, and that healings and miracles and signs and wonders are taking place, you're going to have to tear out this wall and take it all the way to the street, because you're not going to be able to hold them. Now, you didn't hear me, or you'd be shouting right now. That's a good place for you to shout. That's a good place for you to shout. I know it's a Monday night, amen, but I'm here to tell you I have a word from God to share with you, amen, because when, amen, he healed him, revival broke out. Revival broke out, amen. And then, because revival broke out, they honored us with many honors. And when we departed, they laded us with such things as were necessary. Father, we thank you for the reading of your word. Father, we pray now, God, that you will give us an ear to hear and a heart to receive, Lord, what the Holy Ghost has to say. And I pray this all in the mighty name of Jesus, and all God's people say amen and amen. And the question I have for you tonight is, do you believe in this book? Yeah. All right, this is a question and answer forum. Do you believe this is the inspired word of God? Do you believe, amen, this book is who you say you are? Come on now. The book says you are healed and filled, amen, that you have victory. You see, I believe everything in the book. I believe it, who it says I am. I believe what it says I can do and what I can have. I believe that this book is true, and I believe that this book is still very significant even in this day that we live. And if we truly believe in this book, amen, and we believe that God is the author and the finisher of our faith, we have to believe that God orchestrates everything. You see, he's Mozart. He's up there, he's just orchestrating things. Come on now. Your pastor just told you, amen, that in the White House was read this book today out of Isaiah chapter 43, verse 1. God is orchestrating a great revival. Either you get on board or you're going to miss the train. Come on now, I'm just going to tell you like it is, amen. We've got to believe this book, and we have to believe that God orchestrates everything in the book and every person, every place, and everything, even in the life of the Apostle Paul. You see, I have shared with you many times, with many people many times that I do not believe in chance. I do not believe in chance. I do not believe it's by accident that you are here tonight. I believe it is by divine appointment that we are here tonight, that you are here tonight. It is not by chance. It's by divine appointment, amen. And nothing in this book happened by chance, amen. Nothing. Somebody say nothing. Nothing happened in this book by chance, and nothing on this tiny island of Melita happened by chance. God orchestrated it all as he orchestrates you and I. Our whens, our wheres, our hows, and our whys. God orchestrates them all. Now, I just told you the story, amen. These men just survived one of the most horacious storms that they've ever been part of. Now, I don't know if you've ever been in a shipwreck. I don't know if you've ever been in a storm, amen. Being here in Florida, we've gone through probably 5, 6, 7 hurricanes. We've had our roof blown off. I've gone through a tornado up north where we had our roof blown off. I've been in some ships where I thought I was going under. Amen. You got on this side and you could touch the water. And you got back up here and you could see the sky. Then you got over here, you could touch the water. And I was like, God Almighty, get me out of this ship. I want to see dry land. Amen. These men had just been through the most traumatic event of their life. They were in this shipwreck. And as I read this about this story of them landing on this tiny island, I come to realize that in our lives, on the other side of the storm, it's not always a piece of paradise. For you people that like to cruise, it's not always a Coco Cay. All right? It's not always a beach. It's not always a beach. Amen. Often, many times in many places, amen, God will put us in an area so that we can bless others. You see, Moses said, blessed is he who blesses others. You know, your pastor just talked about Dave Lorenzi and Operation Compassion. I have been at the Dream Centers, at the Operation Compassions, the one out in New Mexico. I built the entire upstairs dorm where children can go and be up there. And we have done so much food ministry through them and through the Appalachian Mountains and through so many things. And God puts you in a place so you can serve others, so you can bless others. So it was not by chance that they landed on this island. You got to understand, these people, they were barbarians. They never heard of this man called Jesus. They did not know the plan of salvation. Amen. And so very often we go through so many storms, and we're so busy, and we're so focused on our scars, on our wounds. We're licking our scars and our wounds, talking about the storms, talking about the effects of the storms, the aftermath of the storms, that we miss the real opportunity to make a difference for God. Yeah. You see, God has directed your life. Amen. He's directed your life here tonight to hear this message and hope that you will leave here changed. And I'm here to tell you, if there is to be revival, amen, we have to have an ear to hear what the Spirit has to say. If you want to leave here revived, refreshed, and renewed, amen, then you've got to be prepared. You've got to be ready. You've got to be focused, amen. You've got to be ready for the challenge. Are you ready for the challenge? Then somebody give God praise. Come on, let's give God praise. Now, I want you to take a notice at what happened here when they found themselves on the island. What was the first thing they did? In verse 2 and 3, the Bible says the barbarous people showed us no little kindness. They showed us a lot. For they kindled a fire, and they received us every one because of the present rain, because of the cold, and Paul gathered wood. You see, these men were tired. They were weary. Their strength was gone. And where? They were in a confusing place, a confusing situation. But they took time to build a fire. My God, my God. That right there ought to make a mummy shout. They took time, amen, to build a fire. A fire would comfort them. A fire would change their condition. It would change them from being cold to wet, to warm. It would change them from being dead and dry, or wet and to dry. It would mark them. It would tell others where to find them, where to protect them and guard them from the elements. And I believe there's a spiritual key in this. I really do. I believe that when you are weak, when you are weary, when you are confused, when you just don't know what to do, build a fire. Woo. Build a fire. Stir up the gift that is in you. So the Holy Ghost and fire. Amen. Stir up the gift of God inside of you in the desolate places of your life and watch what God will do. You see, God's fire will comfort you. God's fire will change you. Amen. He will change your condition. God's fire will mark you and send an SOS straight to the throne room of heaven. And it will guard you in this old world. So today, I challenge you. Amen. Faith Temple, let's build a fire. My God, my God, my God. Hallelujah. I want to build a fire. Whoo, there's nothing like a fire. We were up in Virginia the first of the year, and it was cold. It's like 20 degrees. Man, and they had this big old fire pit. And I took Sister Melissa, and man, me and her, we were snuggled up. We had 3 layers of clothing on, but I kept her close to me and me close to her, and we just stayed near the fire. And we let the kids go out and freeze in the snow. Hey, listen, we ain't no dummies. Amen. But what does it take to build a fire in the middle of your situation? And what was it about this fire? Now, this is what I want to get to, and I'm not going to keep you long. I know that you want to go somewhere, but how many will give me 10 minutes? There's 10, there's 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. Listen, you better fasten your seatbelt then. All right. You just gave me an hour. All right. But what was it in particular about this fire? Now, this fire was not a new fire. It was a rekindled fire. You see, they did not have to land on this island and start rubbing sticks together. They did not have to go and try to find a flint rock and some kind of dry material to start a fire. They were very blessed because a fire was already burning. Can I just stop right there and tell you, I'm not looking for a new fire in the church of God. I'm not looking for a new fire in the assembly of God. I'm not looking for a new fire in the churches across America. I'm looking for the same fire that burned in Acts chapter 2. Amen. Where the Holy Ghost fell down upon those. I'm looking for a fire. Amen. The fire of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. I'm looking for a fire. Amen. Give me that old time religion. It'll take us all to heaven. My God, my God, my God. Amen. I don't need a new fad. I don't need a new fashion. Oh, listen here to me. Listen, we need to have a fire. Amen. Like they had in the book of Acts, where they were endued with power from on high, and Peter preached with boldness, and thousands were saved, and people were healed and filled and rekindled. We need a fire that will penetrate every heart, every soul, every mind. I need that fire, and that fire is God Almighty. He's an all-consuming fire, and he will burn in you if you will let him. My God, who was it Moody said? He said, set me a fire so other people can come and just watch me burn. Oh, my God, my God, my God. We need to say, Lord, set me a fire. I want to be on fire. Hallelujah. Amen. The world, it says the fire's gone out. Amen. People in my church tell me I'm crazy. I say, good. I don't want to be normal. Normal's boring. I want to be peculiar. You see, many churches say the fire has gone out. That the fire was for the early church. It's not for the church of the day. Many marriages have said the fire has gone out. They lost that love and feeling. Whoa, whoa, that love and feeling. The problem is not your feeling. The problem is your wood is wet. The problem is that God's people are not stoking the fire. They're not feeding the fire. They're not kindling the fire. We're just barely smoldering. We're barely getting by, and we are comfortable. My God, my God, my God. I was talking today to my India missionary, amen, and he was talking to me about two or three more plants they just planted, and he sent me pictures, and I'll try to get them to you, you can show them, and there was tons of people jam-packed in this one place. There was no padded seats. There was no air conditioning. I spent a whole month in India one time. I'm not a missionary, and I don't want to go back, and so I send him. He can go, amen. All he wants, but I'm here to tell you they were not worried about comfort. They were not worried about air condition. Oh, they were not even worried about seats. All they wanted to do was praise the name of Jesus. They wanted to give God glory. There was fire that was burning in their souls, and I'm afraid that all we're doing as a church is smoldering. And I'm challenging you tonight to stoke your fire. Amen. And blow upon your fire. Amen. My God, my God. Can I get to the heart of the matter? You know what the problem is with the churches of America? Is that we're so scared of the fire, we're afraid that it will get out of control. Woo. We have these mega churches. That if you feel like that you're going to speak in tongues, or you feel like that you have a word from the Lord, they'll usher you out into the foyer. They'll take you out, or you got to write it down and hand it to an usher, or you got to give it to the pastor, or you got to do this. You know what that is? That is putting the Holy Ghost in a box. And you know what the Holy Ghost is going to do? He's going to go to the outside of the door and write Ichabod on the door. We gotta have churches like Faith Temple. We gotta have churches that will be on fire for the Lord. My God, my God, my God. Amen, amen. So many people are trying to control the fire. They want to control it. Oh, I don't want to miss my tie up. You know, I don't. Listen, I grew up where the saints of God. I can remember bobby pins being in fashion. You know, and they would get the shouting. They get the. My mother knew how to clear a pew out. She could clear out a whole pew because the Holy Ghost would get a hold of her and she'd start screaming. I mean, just wow, you know. And she's over here coming this way. You just get out of her way. Go, go, go. I remember those days. Do you remember those days? I long for those days. I long for those days, amen, where we have the fire of God once again consuming us. But we're so scared that the fire might get out of control. You know, I was a kid one time, believe it or not. And my father, I told you last night, yesterday, he was a cattle farmer. And he had about 70 acres in Kentucky, and he rolled his hay. He didn't have square bales. He had rolled hay. And so he would take his rolled hay, and he would stack it up against the barn, and he'd form a big pyramid on the barn. Well, sometimes that thing would be 30 feet high sometimes. I mean, a lot of hay. You have to get through winter, you know, 2-3 deep. Well, I found out as a kid I could dig in the middle of that and have me a nice, warm, comfortable clubhouse. Man, I mean, I did. I would dig out, and I'd take my buddies, and after school, we'd all dig more. Finally, we had us a nice, comfortable clubhouse in there, and it started to get cold, though. And then one of my buddies had matches. And I said, well, we can light us a fire right here. Well, look, we got all kinds of tinder. And man, we lit a fire. And when fire and oxygen and rolled hay gets together, my God, the worst thing I had to do was run down the hill and tell my daddy I'm burning his barn down. Oh, my God. We're so scared that our fires will get out of control. Amen. Listen to me tonight, church. The reason many of us won't stir up the fire is we're afraid of what the fire will do. We're afraid, amen, of what the fire will take from us. We're afraid of what it's going to burn out of us. We're afraid, amen, that it might spread and disturb our comfort zone. Ooh, my preaching is better than your plotting. Maybe you're just taking it in. We're afraid that it might spread. Amen. Take us out of our comfort zones. Well, church of God, hear me tonight. It's time that we allow the fire of God to do what it was intended to do. Because, friend, he is an all-consuming fire, and he is here tonight to purge. He is here tonight to purge. Let me say it again. He is here tonight to purge. To purge everything out of your life that contradicts his word. Anything that weighs you down. Anything that keeps you from moving forward. Anything that besets you. Anything that holds you from being the best you need to be. You see, God gave his very best so you can be your very best. So you can live your very best. So you can be the man of God that he called you to be. So you can be the woman of God he called you to be. Amen. It's time we allow the fire to do what the fire was meant to do. Can you give God praise? Hallelujah. Number two, this fire had to be fed. Now, growing up, I told you about the church yesterday. Well, my house, we did not have air conditioning. We had fans for the summer. And in the winter, we had a stove. Now, we burnt coal and we burnt wood. And it was my job, because I had four sisters. And my brother, he's just a heather, and he never stayed home. So it was my job that I had to keep the fire going all night long. And my daddy, it was his job to work. And so if he got up at 5 o'clock in the morning and the house was cold, guess whose butt was going to get whipped? Wasn't going to be my sisters. It was me. We've got to learn that the fire has to be fed. Listen, as tired as they were, as weary as they were, Paul understood that the fire would not last long unless it was fed. And hear me today, if you are waiting on someone to build you a fire, you're going to be disappointed, honey. Oh, you're not here tonight. My God, what happened to yesterday? Amen. Oh, my God. Amen. If you're waiting for somebody to build your fire for you, you're going to be disappointed. Let me just tell you now. Amen. If you're waiting on someone to build your fire, you're going to live in a life of disappointing. If you're waiting for some miracle worker or some evangelist or some brother or some sister, amen, to do the work for you, you're going to be disappointed. That's why Paul told young Timothy to stir up the gift that is inside of you. We've got to feed it. We've got to stoke it. We've got to blow on it. My God, my God. Paul could not wait for things to get better. He needed to feed the fire because he was cold, because he was wet, because he just went through the storm of his life. Went through the storm of his life. He needed to be revived. Revived. That's why we're here tonight. We need revival. We need to hear the truth. We need to be revived. We need to know that, hey, you know, I've got to stir up that gift. I've got to take notes on Sunday when pastor preaches and take it home and meditate upon it and chew upon it like an old cow chooses its cud. My God, my God. Paul couldn't wait for things to get better. He had to feed the fire. He needed to be revived. So you know what? He became a doer. He became a doer, amen, a doer of the word, and he fed the fire. In the darkest days of David's life, there was no one around to encourage him. Everybody really was against him. In 1 Samuel chapter 30, you'll read that he had to encourage himself in the Lord. You know, there's sometimes we are alone, and we have to encourage ourselves. Why do you think I pat my back sometimes? I say, good job, Pastor. That's a good word. Amen. You won't say amen, I'll say amen. You won't say praise the Lord, I'll say praise the Lord anyhow. Come on now. Amen. It doesn't matter whether there's 50 of us here tonight or whether I'm preaching to 5,000. Amen. I'm going to praise the Lord. Amen. It doesn't matter if I was standing at the foot of the White House. I'm going to still praise the Lord. I'm still going to preach the truth. You've got to feed your own fire. My God, my God, my God. You got to learn how to feed your fire. Amen. You know, when you don't have anyone else in your life, you got to feed your fire. When you don't know what else to do, feed the fire. When you feel like it and when you don't feel like it, you got to feed the fire. Even if you're the only one feeding the fire, you still have to feed the fire. There was no mention of anyone else feeding the fire except the Apostle Paul. You know, there was many nights growing up that I didn't want to get up at 2 o'clock a.m. and check the fire. There was many nights I didn't want to get up and have to go check the fire. But I knew that was my duty. That was my job. Amen. I knew that's what I was supposed to do, was to feed the fire so that the entire family, the entire body, amen, could stay warm. Yeah. Paul fed it. He gathered wood for it. He stoked it. In a way, you could say that he was preparing for revival. We talked about that yesterday. Preparation, remember? Preparation. He was preparing for revival. He was preparing for renewal. He was preparing for that financial blessing. He was preparing for, amen, that healing. Listen to me. You've got to prepare yourself in advance, amen, for your healing, for your deliverance, for your blessing. Amen. Tonight, I've got to ask you, are you preparing for God's fire? Are you expecting, amen, your heart to be ready for the fire? Have you prepared for God to burn anew in your life? Is your worship prepared beforehand? Are you a premeditated praiser? Are you? Do you come expecting? Well, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say, this is a day the Lord has made. I will rejoice because he has made me glad. That's a premeditated praiser. Amen. I went to bed last night thinking about today. I woke up this morning thinking about tonight. I was not worried about the wind. I was not worried about the storms. Yes, I pray for those that are suffering. Yes, I pray for the loss of those ones that have lost lives. But I'm here to tell you that God is in control, and the great Holy Comforter will take control of them. Hear me today. Hear me today. Amen. Our lives are like a vapor. Amen. One day we're here, the next day we're not. The Bible says there's an appointment that every single person has to meet. It's an appointment you cannot cancel. It's an appointment you cannot be late to. It's an appointment, amen, to death. And after that is the judgment. So you better be ready. Amen. That was free, by the way. That wasn't even part of my message. It's good preaching, Pastor. Amen. Hallelujah. It's time we start preparing for a great move of God in this place. You've got to prepare for that. Amen. That's what we're here tonight. We are preparing for a great move of God in this place. Amen. And number three, amen, when you prepare for that move of God, when you stoke that fire and you heat that fire up, the fire brings out the serpent. Woo! That's the part we don't like. Amen. Somebody asked me one time, they said, Pastor, are you one of those churches that handle snakes? I said, yeah, with a hole. I got a 410 shotgun. I'll handle it with that. You know, the best snake I know is a dead snake. Right. Now, they tell me you keep the black snakes away and they'll keep away the poison snakes, but I don't even want those. I got a dog. The Bible is very clear on what brought out the serpent. In Acts 23 or 28 verse 3, there came a viper out of the heat. Now listen to me. Listen to me tonight. That old serpent, the devil, he won't bother a dead, dry church. He won't bother a church as long as it is cold, as long as it is lifeless, as long as it is lukewarm. Matter of fact, the Bible says if you're lukewarm, God's going to spit you out of his mouth. But just as soon as the fire of God begins to stir, he's going to raise his ugly head and try to prevent you from coming to church. He'll jump on you. He'll bite you. He'll cause you to do things you you normally don't do. He'll talk about you. He'll sit in your chair. Oh, my God, my God. He'll try to bring bitterness in your heart. That serpent latched onto Paul's hand, the very hand that was stirring and feeding the fire. That's the hand the serpent went after. And the Lord showed me this morning that the devil, he will do anything, anything to keep Faith Tabernacle, amen, to keep this church, amen, from being on fire from God, from moving forward, anything to keep you from stirring up the gift of God, amen. The enemy will talk about you. People in this community will call your names. They'll even say it's sinful the way you're acting. Think about it. The enemy declared Paul as sinful. This man must be a murderer. He's got to be an escaped convict, but justice won't let him live because a serpent has struck him. If Paul had heard these things, I mean, it might have really got to him. Think about it. If he had heard what they were saying or understood what they were saying, he might have bought into it. He might have bought into the fact, Pastor Smith, that this church ain't never going to be the way it used to be. He might have bought into that. But you know what he did? I love what he did. You know what he did? He didn't get bitter. He got better. And all he did is he shucked that snake back off into the fire. And that's what I'm telling you to do, Zoe. Shake it off. Shake it off. That's all you got to do is shake it off. When they talk about you in school, shake it off. When they talk about you at the job site, shake it off. When people say, oh, this place isn't right, shake it off, because you know that Abba Father resides here, that His Holy Spirit touches you and touches everyone that enters the door. All you got to do is just shake it off. Somebody shake off those holy hands and lift up those holy hands. Come on, shake it off tonight. Shake off that bitterness. Shake off that addiction. Shake off that anger. Shake off that forgiveness. Shake it off. Amen. My God, my God. My lovely wife. Come here, sweetheart. My lovely wife, she likes to take pictures. And so she's got this nice camera, and our daughter was graduating, so my daughter and three or four of her friends, they wanted to go down to a place called Silver Springs State Park. All right, Rainbow Springs State Park. And that's where they wanted her to take pictures of them all. So she went down there like a good mother she is. She went down there and she was taking pictures. And all of a sudden, I get a call. Now, here's the phone call. I'm sitting at my desk at church. And this is from my daughter. Hello? Dad! I'm like, what? What's going on? Mom's been bitten by a snake! I said, where is she at? I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? Dad, we saw the snake and we ran and left her. I said, listen to me. You get your butt back to your mother and you get that snake off of her. And my wife is scared to death of snakes. And that snake had latched a hold of her leg. And when it latched a hold of her leg, it twisted around her leg. And I said, sweetheart, what did you do? She said, all I could think of was the Bible there in Acts where Paul shook it off. So I was shaking it off. I was trying to get it off. And that snake did not harm her, amen, because she is a temple of the Holy Ghost and fire. And I'm here to tell you, amen, when the enemy attacks you and tries to latch a hold of you, all you got to do is shake it off. All you got to do is shake it off. When temptation comes knocking at your door, shake it off. when the doctor says you ain't got but 6 months to live, shake it off. When the enemy comes in like a flood, God said he'll raise a standard, and that standard is Jesus. Shake it off. Look at your neighbor and say, shake it off. Hallelujah. Shake it off. Shake it off. Amen. Tonight, the grip of the enemy, amen, is trying to conceive you, trying to change you, trying to destroy you. But if you will just stir up the fire inside of you, amen, God, amen, will help you to loose him in the name of Jesus. Stop trying to fight the enemy on your own self. In the name of Jesus, shake it off. Shake it off tonight in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. And I'm going to close as the family comes. Somebody give God praise. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The heat felt good to Paul, but it did not feel good to the snake. Ooh. Amen. You see, it's one thing that was very clear in this passage. One thing very clear. What brought out the snake was the heat. Was the fire. The fire. The fire. Amen. The fire. It's what brought the snake off. And the people, they expected Paul to swell up, you know, and die. You know, to get all mad and puffed up, blame it on the pastor. Come on. I'm a pastor, I know. Love us on Sunday, hate us on Monday. Well, today's Monday, so you're the ones who love him. Come on. Unless you're homesick, if you're watching, okay, if you're homesick, I gotta give my excuses here. In case you're homesick, you're excluded from that statement. If you're in jail, you're excluded from that statement. If you're in the hospital, you're excluded from that statement. If you're at work, you're excluded from that statement. All right? Am I missing anything? Everybody else, you should be here. Amen. Amen. See, many people expect you to get all puffed up about these things. Many people expect you to be filled with poison after an attack. They want you to get bitter. They'll come to you, you know, are you going to let that person talk to you like that? Zoe, are you going to let that person talk to you like that? That's what they do. That's what they tell us. Then he'll try to get in your ear. He'll try to tell you that you're never going to be the person that God called you to be. Shake it off. Shake it off. The devil wants you poisoned. The devil wants you in depression. The devil wants you discouraged. But tonight, let me encourage you tonight. Just shake it off. Shake it off. Shake it off. You don't have to take it in the name of Jesus. Shake it off. The devil wants you to give up and just wait for death. But shake it off and declare the word of God that I shall not die but live, and declare the works of the Lord. If you will shake it off, amen, you'll make an impact on the lives of people around you, in this church, in your community, in your family. And I'm going to close. I think one of the greatest things that has destroyed our testimony more than anything else is how we respond to the attacks of the enemy. Think about that. One of the greatest things that destroy our testimonies as Christians is how we respond to the attacks of the enemy. I was on the phone the other night till 3 o'clock in the morning. at 3 o'clock in the morning with a manly, a godly man, and the enemy had attacked. No lives were lost, but had attacked. And this godly man wanted to go do something stupid. I said, you are a godly man. You preach the word. I have seen you cry your eyes out. I have seen you lay hands upon people and they were healed. And you want to what? The enemy will try to push you to that point. Amen. How are we going to respond? How are we going to respond to the attacks of the enemy? And my last point, and here's where I want to encourage you, because this fire was only the beginning. You see, the enemy tried to kill, steal, and destroy, but he failed. Oh, you didn't get that. You'd be shouting already. The enemy tried to kill, steal, and destroy, but he failed. He failed. He failed. He's tried to kill you. He's tried to destroy you. He's tried to rob you of everything, but you're here tonight as a testament that he's a failure and you're a winner. Shake him off. Amen. Enemy tried to kill, but he failed. He tried to distract. He tried to detour, but he failed. Amen. And they responded. The people of that island responded in a life-changing way. And I believe that that physical fire had a spiritual significance because of this. It's what happened afterward. Amen. Afterward. Pastor talked about continuing the revival. It's not about me. It's what happens afterwards. Amen. We were in revival in Illinois, and that was 2 years ago, and that revival is still going on. It's still taking place. Hear me today. It's not about me. It's about God Almighty. Amen. Because of what Paul did, revival broke out on that tiny island. Amen. 3 long months. 3 long months. One thing was clear, that God was at work. You see, revival starts when we stir up the fire and we shake off the devil. Ooh, I don't know about you, but I'm doing a lot of shaking up here. Amen. I'm doing a lot of shaking up here. Revival starts when we respond, amen, to the attacks of the enemy by praising the name of Jesus. Oh, my God. Amen. Revival starts when the enemy attacks you and you shake off every band and you lift up every holy hand. Amen. Giving God praise no matter what. I mean, who would have ever thought that a group of shipwrecked prisoners, outcasts, misfits, drug addicts, whoremongers could make such a great impact on an island? Amen. All you gotta do is shake it off. Shake it off. Amen. Shake it off. God's not through with you. Amen. This is only the beginning, church. This is only the beginning. Just shake it off. Shake it off. And as you stand to your feet, amen, if there's something tonight you need to shake off, I want you to come to these altars. Amen. Hallelujah. If you need to stir up the fire inside of your life, I want you to come again to this altar. Do you hunger for revival? Do you hunger for change? I want you to come to these altars. Amen. Come and stir up the fire. fire. Come on, come on, let's surround these altars. It's still early yet. Come on, it's still early yet. Come and let's just pray for tomorrow. Let's pray for tomorrow that God's going to send who he wants to send. Amen. That people are going to respond to the fire of God. The fire of God. Oh, I want more of you, God. Oh, just begin to cry out to him. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control.
There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love. Here in your love. There's no place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. In your love.
I would rather be. Passion for
give myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. Give myself. My life is not my own. It's to you.
I'm going to let Pastor do that, but I want to read, amen, here out of Isaiah 43, and the Lord just spoke to me and just said to say the ones that are here, to remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old, for behold, I'm doing a new thing.
doing a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and the river in the deserts. The beasts of the field shall honor me, the dragons and the owls, because I give waters in the wilderness and rivers in the desert to give drink to my people, my chosen, these people whom I have formed for myself. They shall show forth my praise. Hallelujah. Amen. We are standing on holy ground. We are standing on holy ground tonight. Do you feel? Do you feel the presence of the Lord? Hallelujah. You can't dismiss this. You can't dismiss this. All I can say is I'm going to turn it over to you, Pastor. I would simply say, take this home with you. Invite someone back tomorrow. Because in Kentucky terms, it's going to get gooder and gooder and gooder. All right? In Jesus' mighty name. Pastor, will you come?
Sister Melissa, you were singing that song, and I was just over there just meditating on the song and worship, and the Lord let me just see, just keep playing right there, if you will. He let me see, as we were said, give myself away. He let me see him when he was going before the cross, and he says, I give myself away. That's all he's asking us to do. Give it all to him.
Yes.
Isn't this been awesome tonight?
Wow.
This is what I've been praying for. I pray the word gets out. I told Austin, go get my sword. I don't use it for not for a cane, but I just want to. I'm ready to fight, brother.
I like it.
You like that?
Caleb, you like that?
I'll tell you when you get one. But I want you tonight, just go. I ain't closing the service. God bless you. Go and find somebody. Get them here tomorrow night. Tell them what's happening. Get on the phone. I want you to pray with me over that that list we prayed of the service. And I'm telling you, some of those MIAs were in this room tonight.
Amen.
Goody, goody, devil. Amen. God bless you. Go in Jesus' name. Oh, I meant to tell you, Martha's niece passed away.